Welcome to a new test and teardown video. This is another Brüel Kjær vibration meter type 2511. And yes, there's a battery inside and a battery check. There's input on the front, but there's also an input on the back. We're gonna look at the back in a second. Linear, whole body come behind. I think this means acceleration, velocity, obviously, and then displacement. The settings for your sensor type. And then we got two different ranges. Oh, let me see if I can have it like that. It's better, right? You need to see this. There's a really, really cool detail about the settings here and the ranges. Look at that one. See? And then it goes down here, right? Isn't that just cool? So that is, there's a round plastic thing with holes in it, right? Connected to that knob. And that knob, there's also a round disc with the numbers. Isn't that just fantastic? Thousand millimeters per second. I mean, here we go. From 0.01. So I guess range, maybe the idea is this is inches per second, and then that range is millimeters, depending on what part of the world we are in, right? That's what I think. I took off the side panel to have a little look, and I am so lucky to see somebody didn't forget the batteries in here. So I think we got 4 D cells. At least that is what I think. Here's the rear panel. I think this is a little bit funny. It's external power supply. It looks like it's running off a positive 14, negative 14, and a plus 4, 2 plus 12. And if you want to charge the internal batteries, okay, plus 12 here. It looks like this connector was in a million times. You can see a lot of scraping around here. Also, this recorder output was also used a lot. So there's also, like I said, input here on the back. External filter, or we could bypass. I mean, that is the external filter if it's here, we in or out, right? High card, external or internal. So that's probably this or that, right? But I don't think it's really complicated with all those voltages and stuff. So what I want to do is, I want to go for internal battery, and then I want to try and connect my power supply here. First I want to ohm, are they in series or what are they? I see some chassis here. Most likely this is, I don't know if this is connected to the batteries. Hang on, I'll figure this out. This is really some kind of equipment. I didn't expect it to be that heavily packed. I mean, look at that. It is packed with boards. Wow, man. This down here looks a little bit like a switch mode converter. This maybe explains why it's able to generate all those different voltages from only 6 volts, right? And then we also got, I mean, on the same board, we also got input amplifier, input super sensitive stuff. I don't know, it cannot be like that, can it? So it got to be like a filter on like an output driver or something. It's just looking a little bit weird. But it's all connected to the DC input. I don't know, that is a little bit confusing. Here on the main board, I also saw a lot of super nice field effect transistor, hand soldered stuff. And also look at the fun thing with the little red paint on top of the transistors. Probably, why is that done? I don't want to try to guess. And there's also a board here with nicely located calibration. It even says on the board exactly what it is. So that is nice. Then we have a way to make it work. Also, if you look around here, how many trimmers do you see? And also over here, wow, tons of trimmers. Oh, there's another one down the hole here. Trimmers all over the place. Lovely. And the bottom of that big PCB here, we got those Teflon inserts. So they're really trying low leakage kind of stuff. That is definitely why you want to do that. I just tried to input 6 volts on the battery connections and I didn't see any action. But also what I see here is a fuse. And that is, yep, that's broken. And that fuse goes directly down to the battery. So maybe somebody reversed it or connected some sort of a charge that is wrong. So, yeah. Oopsie. I will go and fish that little fuse out. And then I know what to expect, what kind of current I can adjust my power supply for. So that's good. Not my lucky day. I'm trying to power this up. 6 volts is connected to the battery here. And listen, when I power this on, it goes like wee, and it draws like an amp. That is not good. Look at this. Let me see if I can move the light a little bit. This corner, this resistor up there, right? So let's have a look at that. Now I power it on. Ooh, something is shining. It's that easy. See, I'm monitoring anything else inside the unit. Nothing gets warm, but that resistor gets very, very warm. And it's actually the reflection in this shiny part down here that creates the other picture. See? Ooh, 60 degrees. We better turn it off again. So that is, let me put on the macro so you can see what happens. See, I can go that close now. Oh, there's a problem with the, like that, right? Now we can really see the resistor. And sometimes I also take my screwdriver like this and then hold it in front here, see? And then I can point with my screwdriver exactly where I think it is, and then, oopsie-doopsie, that is the resistor, right? So why the heck is that happening? Haha, that was my fault. That is so cool. See, now it's powered on, and I can hit the battery check. So that seems to be working. It is now on. And I'm going to measure a little bit here of the power supplies and see if they are running. The problem is, this is of course a switch mode converter, obviously, right? So when the input voltage gets, let me try and show you guys this, gets lower, current consumption gets higher, and I set the current limiter for 600 milliamps. So now I just cranked it all the way up, and now it passes the point of where it goes on. See, if voltage goes up, current consumption goes down. So it uses more or less the same kind of watts. So that is how a switch mode converter works. And the original fuse was 630 milliamps. And that is a little bit on the low side, because when batteries get lower voltage, it's going to, you know, draw more current, and then it's going to blow the fuse. So that's a little bit stupid. So now I put in a 1 amp fuse, but it definitely draw more than 1 amp when it powers up. I have also been sitting here and just enjoying all this analog electronics. It's just full of op amps and transistors and field effect transistors and this is just pure joy to sit and look at. It's just a lot of all the good stuff. I like it. And yeah, over here, this is obviously the input area. They added a little extra shielded plate here. There's also a side panel, but they just wanted a little bit more. I'm curious to see if I can input something in and have this read something out. I actually think I figured this out. Let's get some light down here so you can see what I've done. We got a readout. And the front input and the rear input, it's kind of added together or mixed together. I believe there is an individual amplifier for each input because they behave a little bit different. The front one here, there is 0.0 millivolts on the input DC. And it actually survives if you short the input to ground. It's not hammering out or doing anything crazy. And it is equally sensitive to very, very sub-millivolts inputs. Exactly the same happens with the rear BNC, but it cannot handle any kind of DC on the input. And there is actually a few millivolts coming out of that input. So that means there is some sort of a DC displacement in some of the amplifier field effect transistors or something that needed to be adjusted, or somebody tried to adjust something and just hit the wrong pot meter, and that now there is a little bit of a DC offset on that input. So that means probably nothing when you use the correct type of sensors, because I think they're actually piezoelectric or something like that. So they just act like a capacitor, right? So that means it is okay to short the input. But if I add an attenuator or something like that, then the meter just hammers out and then I can't do anything, right? So what I've done here is 1 nanofarad, 1 mega ohm, and then 47 ohms. So this is my generator here, right? I don't know if you can imagine at, what is that? 3 hertz, 10 millivolts, via a 1 mega ohm resistor and a 1 nanofarad. How much is left into this instrument? I mean, that is not a lot. And I'm not in the most sensitive range here. If I go more sensitive, obviously I'm gonna get a higher reading here, right? And then I can just, instead of having 10 millivolts in, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So yeah, I actually believe this instrument truly works. And it's also responding to peak hold and the different kind of holds. I am now in 1 second, so if I put it for 10 seconds, see what happens here. Let me try and play with the input again. So that was 1 millivolt. Let me crank it all the way up to 10 again. See, it's very slow also on the attack. And now I just hit off. See? Nice and slow. So that means it's really good to detect all sorts of short peaks as well. I actually got some sensors coming my way, but I don't have them yet, so I can't really show exactly the difference between acceleration, velocity, displacement, and all that kind of stuff. So I'm sorry, we will just have to believe that this instrument is working. It is responding to super low frequency AC input, and it is doing, you know, the different ranges here. And if I go even more sensitive here, and I can also go here, and then I can prove the overload is working. And then it takes a little while because I'm now in 10 seconds max hold. See? It's going to stop. Peak detection. Or RMS. That looks also kind of right, doesn't it? Yeah. So, I think this super nice instrument works, and I'm gonna pack it back together here. And I hope you had fun a few minutes. See you again tomorrow for some other funny stuff.